birth of the aerospace industry. And it came to full fruition after World War II, once radar was invented and we started getting more sophisticated types of computers. And by the late 1950s, the transistor, the computer chip, got invented by Jack Kirby out of Texas Instruments. And NASA starts applying it to applied science. And the idea of John F. Kennedy is we're racing with the Soviet Union in the sense that they, in 1957, put a Sputnik satellite up. We make a counter statement with an Explorer satellite. They put Yuri Gagarin, a cosmonaut, into space. We put Alan Shepard. But Kennedy didn't want counter statements all the time. And his word he used over and over again was leapfrog. We've got to leapfrog the Soviets. And the decision was made to have NASA, which had been created in 1958, to start engineering the Apollo program with our eyes of landing on the moon by the end of the decade, beating the Soviets, and doing it in the name of peace for all mankind, and touting it as one of the great human achievements since the beginning of recorded time.
So, Doug, this isn't just a book about the moonshot. It is also a biography of John F. Kennedy, seen through the lens of that historic achievement. And in some ways, it sort of proves the great man theory of history. So tell us a little bit about what it was, what qualities and characteristics that John F. Kennedy had that made this possible and on a faster deadline than a lot of people thought could happen.
Well, he was born in 1917 in Brookline, Massachusetts, so that means he's a child of the age of flight, first generation ever that just grew up with air transportation. But his father, Joseph Kennedy, was what today we call a tiger dad. He just pushed his kid to achieve. And a big thing in the Kennedy household is second place is no good, no silver medallion, you've got to win. And people have an idea of John F. Kennedy being handsome or debonair, witty, but he was a ruthless political animal. He never lost a single election in his life. He won the Congress in 1948, again in 1950. Then he runs for the U.S. Senate in 1952.